There you go.
All right. So Kelly is up in Canada all by herself, and she was in a wreck. And I knew she was, suffering from it, but I didn't know how much. Even though I gave it a lot of credit, it wasn't enough for what she's going through. She, a lot of pain, but she also developed an infection that is resistant. And she's been taking IV antibiotics at home. And she's going in for a test this week to find out if the IV antibiotics have stopped it or not. And remember, she's, I mean, I'm sure she has friends up there, but still, she's a long way away from us. But she said she wanted us to pray, but she said she specifically is asking that when she goes in, it's all gone. And this is a, the kind of bold request that we dare to make. And it's one of those that I think we struggle with, but that's what she's asking. That's what I think we should honor. She has big concerns over this infection. So the prayer that we have for Kelly is that she goes in and that infection is in fact gone. She's still in a lot of pain. So remember Kelly, Virginia, who introduced us to Kelly, is at what is generally her biggest art show of the year, and that's more important than Bible study. So we won't. No, Virginia will see this, and we want to remember her. She asked us to remember this morning. Jean is online, which is unusual for us. And Jean's sister's funeral was this week, and that's difficult. And it was a long, long drive. It was a long drive home too, wasn't it, Jean?
He's not home yet.
Oh, we can't hear him, but yeah. No, isn't he? Because I thought that when I talked to him this
Oh,
week,
okay.
he had driven home. We have, this is Cheryl Thorpe.
Yeah, her uncle, Thanksgiving for her uncle's surgery went successful. Uncle Harold, who's 87, had the hip replacement surgery and is already walking.
That's a very popular thing to do this time too. But this
Yeah.
his name is Harold. It's Cheryl Thorpe's, and it's your, there's Cheryl.
Yeah.
Hello, Cheryl.
And then also prayers for Cheryl. She did find out what's going on with her stomach, and she does have a something that she now has to take 3 months worth of heavy duty steroids. So continue to keep Cheryl in your prayers.
Robin.
There's Robin. Okay, and that's who was next on. Okay, go ahead.
And just in time, Robin, we want to continue to remember her brother and his name,
Brother-in-law Jim
our
Allen.
brother-in-law Jim Allen. The esophageal cancer returned, or
Pancreas.
pancreatic, pardon me, even my dad was esophageal, pancreatic cancer. Continue to remember him and the family. These are also difficult times. Jim Allen, I've got that. Cherie and Phil and Alton and Kathy, these are tough times. I can see that you're weary from what you've been dealing with. So it's good to have you here. Remember them. Please don't forget to remember them. I have, my back is a whole lot better than it was. It's not everything perfect yet, but I'm functional for the first time in a long, long time. And this is one of those things that we've got some theories, but nobody's come up and said, even with MRIs, and said, this is what has been wrong with you. But I actually got out and did some stuff over the last few days, which is a miracle for me. And I appreciate all of those prayers. And I'll mention that Julie is feeling a whole lot better. She's this medicine appears to be the first one. We've had a few that seemed like they did okay, but I don't know how much of that was placebo, but she's doing better. And she even said this week, my pain is almost gone. She's been living with pain and nausea for, I don't know, 12 years, something like that. At times pretty severe. She is feeling better. We have a lot to be thankful for. We have a lot to be concerned about with these people that we know. God, we're always thankful. We try never to forget that. We're always thankful. Each one of us has cause to come to you in thanks and in remembrance. As we do, we have people that we're connected to, people that we care about, people you've sent into our lives. And these conditions are hard. They're part of this life. But we come to you. Kelly has asked that this infection, the medicine she's taken, would have taken it out, and that she is over it. And we bring that as well, very specifically. Be with Kelly and be with the doctors and bring her back to health. It's a very difficult time. We study some things that are hard because we're emotionally attached to things that we've been taught. As a group, God, bring us closer together instead of dividing, letting us divide ourselves as we study this. Let us remember to be kind and patient with each other and try to learn from each other. Amen.
Okay, this is our fourth and final week of our Passover study, which was a preparation for Easter. And just to recap, the first week we went all the way back to God's covenant with the Jews that was made with Abraham. And we looked at the significance of the 14th of Nisan, which was also the day hundreds of years later in Exodus 12, where God proclaimed the first Passover, the night before the Israelites left Egypt to start their 40-year trek to the Promised Land. Then the second week, we looked at the five additional times that the Passover was talked about in the Old Testament. It was not that it was only celebrated those times, but we found out that during those times, people like always change things, even though God told them to do it a certain way. It became not about having it in your house with your neighbors and you doing the sacrifice. It became a thing that the priest at the temple sacrificed, and you picked up your lamb and then took it home. The last time it was mentioned in the Old Testament was 540 years before Jesus. And that was in Ezra. That was the last time it was mentioned in the Old Testament. Last week, we looked at the New Testament, and we looked at different passages in the New Testament where Jesus celebrated the Passover meal with his disciples the night before he was crucified. And we as Christians know that, or have called that his Last Supper. And we have come to know that as the first time communion was served. And we briefly looked at a couple passages in Acts that track the fact that after Jesus was resurrected, the disciples or the believers of the church did get together and taught, did fellowship, broke bread, which that breaking of bread, the meaning of that was to have a meal and to have prayers. And when did they do it? They did it the first day of the week, which was Sunday. So I guess one of the things we wanted to start out is remember the first early church was almost entirely Jews until they started evangelizing to Gentiles. And Jesus rose from the dead, and Jews didn't stop being Jews. So they still, the early church people, still celebrated Shabbat and still went to the temple on Friday night and to Saturday, and they still did that. And we don't know any of this for sure, but there's a lot of speculation that the Jews who had believed that Jesus did raise from the dead and died for their sins, they started gathering Sunday. Now, think about it. Remember, one of the big things we worked on was that a day is from sunset to the following sunset. So Sunday starts Saturday at 5:30. So it's quite possible that they gathered in homes Saturday night, which to them would be Sunday. I mean, just think of that and have this meal. And we don't know that to be a fact. You want to add something, sir?
Well, we know that the Jews continued to go to synagogues, and they didn't move synagogue day to Sunday. So we know that when they're in synagogue, it's Saturday, it's Shabbat. And then they got together on what was their first day of the week with the other Christians, with the body. So that much, I think.
So the only real instruction about the Last Supper or doing communion in the New Testament is in 1 Corinthians. And remember, this is interesting. 1 Corinthians was written by Paul. Paul was, he had gone to Corinth, and he is now writing a letter back to the people from Corinth, and he's correcting them. And this part, he's really correcting them that they're doing this meal all wrong. And and we get some instructions there.
Before you take off on 11, we're in Corinthians.
Yes.
This is Paul, and Paul is what would probably pass for an attorney now. Paul is very well educated, and when he makes an argument or he states a case, he's very methodical. He lays it out, and he tells you, this is what I'm telling you about. There's never any gray area. People lift things out of context in Paul's writing, and you absolutely cannot do that with Paul, because he goes on this long step-by-step, this and this and this and this. So you have to know what is he talking about, rather than trying to just take a few verses out of context. And so even though Mary's on 11, I'm going to skip back, because Paul is talking about something very definite here. And he starts out at the beginning of 10. This is 1 Corinthians 10. And he's talking about the Jews in the wilderness, how God dealt with them and led them out of Egypt. And starting in verse 5, he says, "Nevertheless, God was not pleased with most of them, for they were struck down in the wilderness." And then verse 6, "These things took place as examples to keep us from craving evil things as they did." Right? Paul comes right out and says that this Passover and Exodus are there to point out to us and to serve as examples. Sometimes a bad example is as good as a good one. You know what not to do. And he's saying these were in place as examples to keep us from craving evil things as they did. So as we go forward, this is all part of one extended argument. You know, you can think of, I always say a lawyer, because that's kind of how he lays his cases out. So understand that he's talking about that. He's talking about what we call communion, observing the Last Supper, but he's gone all the way back to the Jews coming out of Egypt for a reason, because that Passover was there to point us towards what happens in Jerusalem with Jesus' sacrifice, with the cross, with the atonement for sins. So this is all related. There's no question what Paul is telling us. And then as Mary's going to read, he's going to go forward and talk then about this Last Supper, about communion.
And I guess the one thing to remind everybody, when Jesus did the Last Supper, he said, you know, when you break bread and share the cup, do this in remembrance of me. That's the only instruction he gave about this thing we call communion. So as Scott said in the prayers, and as something we struggled with this week, you know, baptism and communion are one of those two things that you guys are so loaded, depending on what church you were raised in. And I can say that as being raised a very strict Catholic and going to Catholic school for 12 years of my life and never missing Mass for 25 years. So, I mean, I can say that honestly, that communion is one of those things that is very loaded with theology that, but what we're trying to do is take it back to what the scripture says, right?
We deal here with what does this say? I mean, we've been told a lot of things. We did a study one time and we talked about baptism and infant baptism. And I tried to make it real clear. There's nothing wrong, but there is a personal acceptance and a personal relationship with Christ that doesn't come as an infant. And we had someone get really, really angry and say, I just don't think my parents did anything wrong when they had me baptized as a baby. And I had said the words, there's nothing wrong. This is emotionally charged. And if you feel that, give us a little bit of a break, kind of, you know, let's listen to what's being said, because what we're talking about is what's actually in the scriptures. And there are other things that we can try and fill in gaps with. We're not going to do that.
1 Corinthians chapter 11, verse 17. In the following instructions, I have no praise to offer because your gatherings do more harm than good. First of all, I hear that when you come together as a church, there are divisions among you. And in part, I believe it. And indeed, there must be differences among you to show which of you are approved. Now then, when you come together, it is not the Lord's Supper you eat. For as you eat, each of you goes ahead without sharing his meal. While one remains hungry, another gets drunk. Don't you have your own homes to which to eat and drink? Or do you despise the church of God and humiliate those who have nothing? What can I say to you? Shall I praise you for this? No, I will not.
Let's stop there.
Okay.
So, they're following this instruction that Jesus has given at the Last Supper to do this. And as often as you do it, remember me, right? They're having the observance. So keep in mind, there's no doubt that's what Paul is talking about. He's absolutely describing a Last Supper observance or a communion observance. And he's really, really harsh with them. I mean, really harsh. He says, what you do when you come together, I don't know what you're doing, but it's not the Lord's Supper. I mean, he says those words. You're doing something, but this ain't that. You're not doing that. And he says, so even though you are coming together on a weekly basis and you're sharing, there is a meal involved, and that seems like a good thing. Am I going to praise you for that? Am I going to commend you? Said, nope, I won't do it. Remember, and he is really getting on this church at Corinth. What you do is not the Lord's Supper. And it's, I mean, it's bold and it's hard hitting. And then he goes on to explain why.
He does. You can assume a couple of things here. First of all, that the early church, this group of believers that were getting together, is of different socioeconomic backgrounds. And so there are people with money and there are people without money. There are people with food and there are people with not so much food, okay? And some of the studies that we did, they said, you know, think of this as a potluck dinner. They say, you know, well, but it's a good thing, you know. So say they're getting together Saturday night after they've been to temple, and now the Christian believers, those who are followers of Christ, are going to get together, and they are coming to someone's home and they're bringing food. Okay. So have that image as I go on.
We want to talk about what he says, that you get together and while one remains hungry, another gets drunk. And there are several things through here that indicate what he's describing is they have a meal. They don't have a sliver of bread and a little taste of something to drink. They come together for a meal. And this is a, in our society, is a hard thing. We're so busy all the time that and I'm getting one look back there, you know, but think about how seldom, but it's hard because we're so busy and we wind up with other things taking the place of this. We're not intentional about it. They were doing it apparently every single week. And they're having a meal, and it says that some people remain hungry. So what Mary is saying, what she already said, is you have believers from all walks of life, and some of them have next to nothing. We don't even understand next to nothing in this society, especially in this country. There, I know there are people that have, you know, food anxiety and everything, but compared to this, these people are poor. These people really, really are struggling. And it's where the Romans have left them. So there are other people, though, that are believers, that are part of this, that have plenty. So they show up for this meal. And what it appears, we're going to talk about it more, but it appears that what happens is that people who show up and have food to bring are saying, well, I'm getting my share. I brought this. I'm going to get my, and they get more than their share. So they dig in and start eating before the others have shown up. And you get people who show up that are literally hungry, which is not the purpose in this, but it's part of it. It's a meal that they share together. So that's this idea of some of them being fed and some of them going hungry. And then others, because there's wine involved, and certainly at the Passover, they had 5 cups. There are people that are showing up and drinking down all the wine and getting drunk. And he's telling them, whatever it is you're doing, it's not the Lord's Supper. And then he proceeds, as he's starting to tell them why.
1 Corinthians 11, verse 23. For I received from the Lord what I also passed on to you. The Lord Jesus, on the night he was betrayed, took bread. And when he had given thanks, he broke it and said, this is my body, which is for you. Do this in remembrance of me. In the same way, after supper, he took the cup, saying, this cup is the new covenant in my blood. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me. For as often as you eat this bread and drink this cup, you proclaim the Lord's death until he comes. Therefore, whoever eats the bread or drinks the cup of the Lord in an unworthy manner will be guilty of sinning against the body and blood of the Lord. Each one must examine himself before he eats of the bread and drinks of the cup. For anyone who eats and drinks without recognizing the body eats and drinks judgment on himself. That is why many among you are weak and sick, and a number of you have fallen asleep. Now, if we judged ourselves properly, we would not come under judgment. But when we are judged by the Lord, we are being disciplined so that we will not be condemned with the world. So, my brothers, when you come together to eat, wait for one another. If anyone is hungry, he should eat at home, so that when you come together, it will not result in judgment. And when I come, I will give instructions about the remaining matters.
So we're going to try and convince you of a couple of things about this. And it's, some of it may be hard to swallow, and no pun intended. You want to say something?
No, go ahead.
Start. I want to skip down near the end. Let's see. What is this? This is verse 33. I'll come back to the other. But it says, so my brothers, when you come together, wait for one another. What does that tell you? It tells you that there are people that have not been waiting for the others, for some of the others. And this is the purpose in it. So what it appears is that there are people who are showing up with food, who have food to eat, and instead of eating before they come, they make a point of not eating before they come, so they're ravenous. So as soon as they get there, they just start eating up all the food. And that's not the purpose in this. This is one of the big reasons why he's telling them, I don't know what you're doing. It's not the Lord's Supper. So when you get there, wait for the others. This is not about the food. It is a meal, but it's not about the meal. It is about the communion with each other. And it is about memorializing, doing what we were told, that when we do this, which is to share the meal with each other, that we do it in remembrance of him. And so you can see how that has gotten completely upside down. And what it winds up doing is it winds up worsening the differences between the people who have money and the people who don't. And you get people who are totally left out of this. The one thing that we shouldn't have at a Lord's Supper celebration is anybody feeling left out by anything. You want to add anything on that?
Yeah.
He says, go ahead.
Excuse me. This is not only a matter of form over substance, but it is that you've missed the whole intent of sharing the body of Jesus.
Absolutely. That's what this is. That's what he is saying. This is.
And if you do that, if you buy that, then you understand the agitation that Paul is feeling. I'm not going to do that, guys. You're in the wrong track.
Yeah, no. This is serious. He's going to a lot of effort here to explain, talk about this remembrance of the Last Supper, of the Lord's Supper. We're not going to get to it. We've talked about it before, but this is right before he goes into that chapter about love. I mean, it's right before it. This is all sort of one thing, that love is patient, love is kind, love doesn't boast. I mean, right on the heels of that, and this is very Paul. First, he dresses them down, and he says, you guys have missed the point. As Gene says, they've chosen form over substance. Yeah, they're having a meal, but the substance is not there. And then he sees fit to go in and talk to them about what we call the love chapter, that you know, you've got to love your neighbors. If you show up, you bring food, you know people are coming hungry, and you make sure and just, you know, get down as much as you can because it's yours, you've missed the point.
And, you know, we just finished a long, many-week study on Matthew. And remember, the whole Gospel of Matthew started out with the Sermon on the Mount, where Jesus said to the masses, this is a message to a different people, that you are all part of the body. And so this is a different group of people. I mean, I see some of the Jews still going to synagogue, and some of the people that felt like they never belonged because they weren't good enough, they came to this. You know, this was the body of believers, where Jesus says, this is for, I came for all of you.
And you begin to see that all of these things are so tied together. Yes, John Paul. So, mic on?
Yeah. All right. So to me, he's pointing out, don't go down the road the Sanhedrin did. The Sanhedrin were given the authority, and they just took it and stole it and ran off with it and left everybody else behind. Oh, you're not good enough. You're not this. You're not that. Laughing at the poor people when they go to give, you know, like the lady that gave all she had, that one little pittance.
That was what I was in the process of getting to. Thank you. You want to go?
Oh, I jumped ahead.
No, perfect, because I was jumping to the side, so it's perfect.
So what he was doing was pulling back on the rein, saying, wait, don't go down that road. Don't bring what Christ has done to that end. He did this for everyone.
Correct.
And no one is above anyone. And you're doing it, if you're doing this, do it for the reasons that he died, that he sacrificed himself. Don't get on this wagon of, oh, I'm better, I've got this, and I'm hungry, and, you know, to heck with them, they're dirty. He was really, really, to me, pointing that out, the difference, and the caution, don't get on this Sanhedrin kind of thing where you know, Sadducees and Pharisees were above everybody. And they left it to lots of people behind.
Let's take that little jump to the side. You mentioned it. I was just about to. There's an incident where there's a woman. They're in the temple court, and there are people that are giving money. And the way they set that up is they have these big urns, these big vases, if you will, and people come up and dump their money. And it's like the returns on a slot machine in Vegas. It's designed to make a lot of noise. The more money you dump in, the louder it is. And they get to preen around like peacocks. The ones who have a lot of money is they come up and they splash that money in, and it makes a whole bunch of noise. And you can get some idea, ooh, they gave a lot of money because of the sound, right? And then you have poor people who are embarrassed to come and bring their gift to the Lord, to bring their sacrifice to God. They're embarrassed. And he mentions this one woman who brings two little copper coins. They're called mites. And that's like a dust mite. There's tiny little coins. And when she drops them in, they don't make any noise to speak of. And people are embarrassed to bring their sacrifice to God because it's not as much as somebody else. And he says, I'm going to tell you, she gave more than those people who brought a whole lot of money, because she brought all she had. And you see in all these stories, you see this common thread that connects all of it eventually. There are people out here who have taken what we'll call the church and used it as a way to draw attention to them, to show off, and to show off that they got money. This is the same thing that's happened with the Lord's Supper. How does that tie into us? We don't eat meals the way, you know, they brought meals together, except maybe at a potluck. And it's not really how we do the Lord's Supper. Yeah. So this is unlikely to directly, say, impact any of us. But at the same time, what he's pointing to is the fact that the whole purpose of this remembrance, not the whole purpose, but a big part of it is that it makes us one people. And when you do things that make us not one people, you've missed the point. You just about as well not do it at all. Does that make sense? Does that, you know, are we buying into that? Yes, sir.
So I meant to ask this question earlier when Mary was reading off of 10 verses 5 and 6. Phone book Bible here is the ESV. So when it says, nevertheless, verse 5, nevertheless, with most of them, God was not pleased, for they were overthrown in the wilderness. So is the word overthrown here being indicating like when the Jews just were made to walk for 40 years or something that would have taken 3 months versus that they were overthrown to their evil desires and they became idolatrous and made the golden calf and all that kind of stuff. Because then in verse 6, it says that this is for you not to do the same sort of evil. So what is your interpretation of overthrown in
the wilderness? Well, he is absolutely talking about those 40 years in the wilderness. He is. And they make golden calves. They sexual immorality. I don't know. He names several things that they're guilty of, but overthrown in the wilderness, they died. That overthrown is they died. God said, none of you are going to be a part. You're not going to go to the promised land. So the whole purpose in that statement is to say God wasn't pleased with them. And here's why. You know, we can get into more specifics, but the point is he's explaining to these people how the Israelites did certain things and God was very displeased with them. The inference, I think, is more than just an inference. He's saying what you're doing is no different and no better
than what they did.
Yeah. Yeah. That's the message. And so go ahead.
The three things, because we've got a lot of time here. The three things that this passage in 1 Corinthians 11 is, if you look at any denomination, it's where they pull from for how we do communion, okay? But But some of the points that I think when we read it and when we study it, some of the things that either have been missed or mistaught or just missed, or we just didn't hear it, were, first of all, one of the big purposes was to bring the body together, which was what Scott was talking about, the communion of the group of believers. The second thing that is used in this thing is this idea of examining yourself. And in our churches, it has become that, you know, you're supposed to sit before communion and figure out all the sins you've done.
Politely.
Okay, well, but I'm just
we got to approach it.
Okay. What this is saying, though, in context is, do you want to talk about what he is saying? He is telling them, he has just gone to say that you have a group of believers, and some of you with money come and eat a whole bunch of food and get drunk. And what he's saying is, before you eat, think about what you have done, how you've acted to your fellow believers, the people that you are having communion.
Yeah, let's talk about that. So first of all, this meal is once a week, right? And I'm from a lot of conversations over a lot of years, I know that there are people that read this about having all things in common, and it just scares them to death. Because that means I'm going to have to give up all my stuff. Do I have to move like a family into my house with me to properly do this? What's being discussed here? And this is why I started the way I did. This is about the observance of the Lord's Supper. Trying to then extrapolate into a bunch of other stuff gets us into trouble. Let's look at what Paul is saying. This is the observance of the Lord's Supper. Consider that there are people going there. I guess, as Mary said, they may well have come from synagogue or temple, and they're hungry, and they don't have any food. And there are other people who come, and the idea is that we get together and share. It's once a week. You don't have to adopt people. The purpose in this observance of this commemoration is, we were told, Paul says, I have told you what was given to me directly from the Lord. And that is that on the time, Mary discovered this week, by the way, it says on the night he was betrayed. That statement probably most accurately is at the moment he was being betrayed, Judas has left. And as he's being betrayed, Jesus gets together and breaks bread. And Paul reminds us, and he says, I got this straight from the source, which is something we'll reserve for another time. But the purpose in this is that they get together and have this communion. And so they're you see how much better it would be if the people who had would share. It's one meal a week. One meal a week. It's a thing that they're so wrapped up in their stuff that they can't share a little bit of food one meal a week. And it of course it misses the point. But here's the hard part. And let me go ahead and get. I think I'm avoiding this. What he says is, before you partake, examine yourself. Right? And what this has been, he says that whoever eats and drinks this feast, this Lord's Supper, in an unworthy manner, the way this has been portrayed in a lot of churches is that if you have any sin in your life and you eat the bread and drink the wine, you're going to hell. The King James Version says, it's a bad translation, but it says, whoever eats and drinks unworthily eats and drinks damnation. Now, that word, I'm sorry, but that word is condemnation. What I want to try and convince you of, Paul is very meticulous, right? Paul is very, very meticulous, and he does things step by step by step. He's in the process of talking about this relationship between believers, okay? And if you really look at what it says of not discerning the body, he says two things. They eat and drink unworthily or in an unworthy manner. But this is very much, this whole section is in relation to, well, it deals with our relationships with each other. And if you come there and you eat up all the food, knowing that somebody else is going to be coming hungry, that's an unworthy manner. It just is. And he says, if you eat and drink in an unworthy manner, you bring condemnation on yourself. You bring judgment is there. This particular piece, I believe, and I think there's enough evidence, has been abused so badly. They scare people to death about communion. Oh my gosh, did I forget? Did I forget to remember something that I've done wrong? If I eat this, I might be dooming myself to hell. This is a terrible thing. If it says that, it says it. But what it says, if you really look at what he says and the what he's on, he's dealing with these people who are coming together for the Lord's Supper, and then they're not behaving as part of a body with the other people. So I want to read this again, if you don't mind. He says, whoever eats the bread or drinks the cup of the Lord in an unworthy manner, right? You eat it or drink it in an unworthy manner will be guilty of sinning against the body and blood of the Lord. You're there to commemorate by being a part of the body, and you're doing the exact opposite. You're creating this caste system, and whoever eats and drinks in an unworthy manner is guilty of sinning against the body and blood of the Lord. Each one must examine himself or herself before he eats of the bread and drinks of the cup. For anyone who eats and drinks without recognizing the body, notice what he says. He says unworthy manner, and then he tells you what the unworthy manner is. Anyone who eats or drinks
without
recognizing the body eats and drinks judgment on himself. That is why many among you are weak and sick, and a number of you have fallen asleep. And that fall asleep means died. Now, here's a hard one. I wish I could get out of having to deal with this. That is why, what is why? Coming together and eating and drinking in an unworthy manner. And he says, that's why some of you are sick and some of you have died. And I have no basis to tell you anything behind that. It says what it says. Does that mean that sometimes there are sicknesses that are the result of sin, of doing that? Well, that's what Paul says. So you can either say, well, I think Paul got this one wrong, or you can look at it, and as they say about Mary, keep these things and ponder them in your heart. It's an interesting observation that Paul makes here, and he says, I got it, you know, straight from the source. Yeah?
Well, he also says, and I think it's consistent with the idea that Jesus didn't come to condemn. He didn't come to judge you. You do that yourself if you do not understand who Jesus Christ is and you do not believe who Jesus Christ is. You wouldn't go to communion at all if you had that expectation.
There is condemnation. There is judgment. And this is the thing I've struggled with this last week. Oddly, I've had several conversations about this. And I will tell you that this section is specifically about the Lord's Supper.
Yeah.
Don't lose sight of that. It's clear. If you go through and really look carefully, if you reread it after the fact, you're going to pick up on the fact he is talking to them explicitly about one thing, and that's about the way what they've done to the Lord's Supper. And so that someone who eats and drinks in a unworthy manner, these, and he's told you what those are, that they come together and they get drunk. They just overdrink the wine. They eat food that other people need. They could go home and have a meal, but they come here and eat up all of this food. You do that. Consider yourself. It says, you know, if it says that we're supposed to, I want to get this exactly right. We're supposed to essentially judge ourselves. Let's go to 33 or 31. Now, if we judged ourselves properly, we would not come under judgment. But when we are judged by the Lord, we're being disciplined so that we'll not be condemned with the world. So what is that? That comes right on the tail of him saying some of these people, the reason they're sick, it's a consequence. And that when God judges us, there's a correction. Now, does that mean every time someone gets sick, it's a judgment because of something you've done wrong? No, it doesn't mean that. It is a part of living in this world. I will tell you that there are times, though, that it is. And I accept it because that's sort of the arrangement I have. That's what I have accepted, that there are times that I require correction. And it's never pleasant. And it's not supposed to be pleasant. It's supposed to be something that will remind you, that will point you back and go, oh, you know, I guess I was being a jerk, right? I'm not certain about this thing that I've gone through. I don't even have words for how bad the pain is. But I can tell you, like Kelly, when I hear that she's been in chronic pain, I hear that different than I did a month and a half ago. And it's easy to hear about someone in pain and go, oh, that's a terrible thing, and I should remember to pray for them, and I probably won't. It's another thing to actually really, really relate to that and go, oh, yeah, no, I get that. I understand it. This is who we're supposed to be for each other. So he is telling them in no uncertain terms that there is judgment, there is condemnation. And when these things that they're doing by leaving people out, by setting up a caste system with the Lord's Supper, he's saying there's going to be a judgment for this. There has been. That's why some of you, and who is he going out to one of the Pharisees and saying, oh, you know what? You aren't nice to the people. No, these are believers. These are people who are supposed to know better. These are people who have gotten the message and then forgotten the message. And he says, some of you, it has affected your health. Yes, sir.
Okay, so I got one of the questions. So how does this relate to Romans 8:1? Okay, therefore, there's no condemnation for those who are in Jesus Christ. Two, I don't know that anybody could ever profess perfection. So, you know, we're all sinners, and, you know, if we're left to our own, we're left to damnation. So,
let me finish up because Mary's over here hitting me because we're supposed to have a communion here in a minute. Let me see if I can do this quickly. Clearly, this section is about them. And about what they're doing with the Lord's Supper. Not that other people can't do it. We're supposed to learn from them. Why? Because he told us that. Just like with the Jews, he's leaving a record so that we can all learn from their bad example, right? And as far as condemnation, it does say they eat and drink judgment on themselves that they have sinned against the body and blood of Christ. Does it say that they're doomed, that they're going straight to hell, that God will abandon them over it? It doesn't say that. Both of those things are true. Both of those things are factual. But we also have to understand that the kind of condemnation he's talking about in Romans is literally this eternal separation from God. This particular word, and it's a difficult word actually, but it has to do with your correction, judgment, correction. This is what it is. He's correcting us. But I hope what I really want to get across, and Mary, I'm in trouble because she keeps hitting me because we're going to do this. What I want you to hear from this, people have told you that before you eat bread and drink that little cup of wine, that if you have any outstanding sins, you're doomed. Eats and drinks damnation. That is King James. That's not what this word says. These are believers, and we're told that neither, you know, heights nor depths nor, you know, nothing separates us from the love of God, right? So we've got to transition into this. I hope we've done a decent job.
Well, and so the thing, the purpose, the three purposes were, you know, there was a communion of believers. One, you were to examine yourself. Have you done something not well with the believers that you're with? And three, that you are celebrating it. You are remembering Jesus's death for the purpose. What was the purpose of his death? And the purpose of his death was so for the forgiveness of our sins. And so those are the three things. I'm going to, while we are going to that, I've actually found, I listened to a lot of communion hymns this week, and I realized that we do like really weird things with a lot of communion hymns, but I found a song. Can you put it on, Scott? And that I think is biblically correct. What do you, sorry, I don't want to mess it up.
And
make sure we hit that thing.
I didn't. Let me try to hit that thing. We're oh, cheer sound. Here we go.
Okay.
Sorry about the delay. I thought, I got here this morning. I turned the computer on. And it hit Zoom and it says, installing updates, please wait. So they do it on Saturday night and we wake up to a new world a whole lot of the time. Let's see if we can.
Called in remembrance of me.
It sounds like a song.
It is. And
I think you just need to hit it.
Hit where?
Right here.
Well, I had it open already.
Okay. Read yourself, Jean.
Oh, I hate this.
This is my body. Given for you, this is the cup that holds the blood of the new covenant. This is forgiveness, simple and true. This is the way that I have made for you. Before you eat, before you drink, take a long look inside and tell me what you see. He said, do this in remembrance of me. Do this in remembrance of me. This is the bread of the love of Christ poured out anew. This is the Son of God who died for you. Before you eat, before you drink, take a long look inside and tell me what you see. Oh, do this in remembrance.
Quick thing to say, and then hopefully some of you will go with us. Kind of a hard part. There are people who come to gatherings, like churches, as a social event. And I think, and this is what John Paul just brought me, it's a thing from Hebrews that talks about condemnation by trampling the body. There almost certainly are people participating at this time in the Lord's Supper who don't believe any of it. That's a sad thing to say. And it's a hard, and what I won't do is look at any individual person and go, I don't think that one really believes. That I don't do. But in general, you have to understand that there is, you know, there are always going to be people that it's a social event. And what you can't do, what we can't do, is allow this observance, this Lord's Supper, to go that route. That's what has happened. I'm going to say something that's going to get me into trouble, and Mary's going to whack me for saying, I'm going to say one last thing. We have in this town community table, right? You're familiar with community table, where it was every Tuesday, people come together and the churches feed them. I got into a whole bunch of trouble because I kind of loudly said, look, we also need to be telling them about the love of God. We need to be telling them about Christ and the sacrifice and the atonement and the forgiveness of sins. It's good to feed people, but we also need to be doing these other things. And they disagreed with me just as forcefully as I disagreed with them. That we're simply having a meal, and it's not the same thing. And what began to happen was there were people coming from out of town who said, you know, we would like to have a private table. We will come, we will all sit together, and we'll eat our meal, and when we're done, we'll pack up and leave, and you guys can clean, you can serve us, you can clean up behind us. And there's no socialized, no communion outside of their own little group. And I said, I don't think that's what we're here for. I don't think, even though it may be a nice thing to provide a meal for people, we're here for the purpose of pointing people to Christ. Yes? They wouldn't even allow people to sing hymns anymore, much less do a scripture reading. We don't want to proselytize. So, there's nothing evil about it, except that as a church, as a body of believers, I was pretty sure that it's our duty, it's our place to be using this as an opportunity to tell people. And if we're going to share that meal, let's share it this way, which is in remembrance of him. And it wasn't happening. And this is why I'm so well loved in the community, of, you know, among a whole bunch of other reasons. So the point of this is, what does this say for us? And it says that this sharing of meals, this sharing of life with each other is important. It's important enough that Paul devotes a whole chapter to it. And we're told explicitly one thing: do this in remembrance of me. And as often as you do it in remembrance of me. And there are no rules set down for what kind of food. There's no rules, although they had bread, but with what these people were doing, they're just bringing food. They're having a meal. This is different from Passover. Here at the end, Jesus was celebrating Passover. And it tells us that that points us ahead, or Passover pointed us ahead to his sacrifice. You see the relationship, but they're not the same thing. So now, and I've gone over time. Will you want to go do this? You want to explain it? And I'll...
I'll get the stuff. You pray.
All right. So it says that as he's being betrayed, as Judas is in the process of betraying him, he took the bread and he broke it, which I've done. Jesus told us, this represents my body. This is my body broken for you. And that's the thing that as we're together that we have in common, that his body was broken for us. And this is a new covenant in my blood. When he gives them the wine, we're having grape juice. This is a new covenant in my blood. This is my blood shed for you. I'm sorry. So we're going to do this and try and do it with that in mind. It's just gotten louder.
You want to take this stuff?
All of you sitting at home, there are so many of you, and I have started to say this several times recently. It's funny. All of you are very, very special to us in a whole lot of ways. It's amazing every week when we show up and all of you are here and all of you in the house as well. You're very, very important to us. This is a body. We are thankful, but we are thankful for the sacrifice, for the gift, the forgiveness of sins, the atonement that brings us together, that makes us part of one body. And so he broke it and he gave thanks. God, we are thankful. We have this group, we have this body of believers all over the world. But there's a group that you've brought together here. And we're thankful that you saw fit, that you love us enough to have sent your son. That Jesus said, if there's a way around this, if there's a way to not drink this cup, that's what I want. But not my will, but yours. We're grateful for the provision that was made to reconcile us to you. Thank you for the gift. Thank you for the sacrifice. And thank you for what you've made available to us, what you have brought us into through that. Took the bread and ate. This is his body broken for us. And then he took the cup. They very likely had one or just a couple. But he said, this is a covenant. This is a promise, a never ending. That's what a covenant is with God. It never ends. This is a promise. This is a relationship in his blood, in his sacrifice. We're taking it today to remember the sacrifice and to take part in a shared body between all of us. Thanks, God, for the provision, for the reconciliation, for the forgiveness of sins, and for each other. We have come to the conclusion, we've talked about it several times, when we moved here, our intention was, and we've said this, to begin having more people over to share meals. I think it's a good practice. And I think that we're just about to the point in the remodeling. It is the sharing. It is the sharing and remembering that we can, you know, we can do at any given time. Two of us is enough. But our prayer is that we'll be able to bring more of you here to share the kind of communion that we're supposed to have on a regular basis with each other. You have anything else you want to share? I hope this cleared some things up. I hope we didn't leave, you know, anything too confused. But we're grateful to God for each one of you. And we think it every week. A lot of you, you know, you see when you show up, you see that we're all pleased to see each other and to see you. This is the body. Anything else?
No, we will put a devotional for Easter up. We will not be here next Sunday. We'll be in Tucson with our grandbaby, and we'll also put out what our next study will be. So you guys have a wonderful Easter.
Thanks for being with us.
Safe travels.
Thank you.
Bye-bye.
Happy Easter. Enjoy that grandbaby so much.
I will.
Bye. Have fun.
Bye, everybody. Have a great week.
Bye.
Bye-bye.